Good morning. Today we are going to study the type vouch area which belongs to the class Sandow 5A. You might have heard about vouch area in our previous classes. We have discussed different classes, and during that time I have just mentioned about vouch area, about its mode of attachment using Haptera and all. I hope you remember that. Anyway, we'll pass on to the class. It's just like other algal members. It is also a freshwater algae. That means it is found in ponds, streams, etc. And very few species are marine, and some terrestrial species are also seen in damp soil. And the common Indian species are Voucheria sessilis, Voucheria uncinata, and Voucheria amphibia. In which Voucheria sessilis, it is both found in land and water. It is terrestrial and both aquatic. And uncinata is seen only in water. It is aquatic, whereas in Voucheria amphibia, it is amphibious. Then, coming to the vegetative structure of Voucheria, this is how it looks like. This is the algae Voucheria. This is the vegetative structure of Voucheria. And it is a branched thallus. You can see several branches here. And what is its shape? The shape is cylindrical and aseptate without any septa. But during the time of reproduction, septa develops. Aseptate, siphonaceous. And the septa develop at the time of reproduction. And its color is generally yellow-green in color. You can see here the color. It is generally yellow-green in color. And the branching is generally monopodial branching. Here all these are monopodial branching, but in some cases dichotomous branching is also seen. Then thallus is multinucleated, and if a thallus is multinucleated, that condition is known as cenocytic. So Voucheria is cenocytic. The numerous nuclei are seen in the thallus, in the periphery. Mostly it is seen in the peripheral portion. Numerous nuclei are seen. And numerous yellow-green chromatophores containing chlorophyll A, E, carotene and xanthophylls are also seen near the periphery of the thallus. Here you can see numerous chromatophores near the periphery. Nucleus is also seen in the peripheral portion. And the reserve food material in Voucheria, it is mainly oil. It can be oil globules or oil droplets. So it is a yellow-green filamentous algae, cenocytic, aseptate, branched, mostly monopodial branching. And sometimes it is dichotomous branching is also seen, and aseptate. And the thallus attaches to the substratum by basal rhizoid-like structure known as Haptera. In this picture, you can see here a structure. Here you can see a structure, and this is a rhizoid-like structure which helps Voucheria to attach to its substratum. And this rhizoid-like structure, it is known as Haptera. Rhizoid-like structure is known as Haptera. And the cell wall of the filament consists of two layers. Out of that, inner layer is made up of cellulose and the outer layer is made up of pectin. And there is a large vacuole filled with cell sap in the center of the filament, and it extends throughout the length of the filament, pushing cytoplasm to the peripheral part. In this picture, you can see this is a large vacuole, isn't it? An empty portion is seen here, white color portion. This is large vacuole. It is filled with cell sap. So because of the presence of large vacuole in the center, the cytoplasm is pushed towards the peripheral part. And embedded in the cytoplasm, there are numerous nuclei. So, numerous nuclei are present, so it is known as cenocytic. And all cell organelles, oil lobules, stored food, etc. Also, chromatophores. So, that is about the vegetative structure of Vaucheria. Now, come to the reproduction. All other algal forms, there is a mode of vegetative reproduction by fragmentation. Fragmentation means the filaments breaks into small fragments, and each individual fragment develops into new thallus. And the asexual reproduction is the main form of reproduction in Vaucheria, and it can be through the formation of zoospores or a planospores or a echinet, cyst, hypnospores, like that. So first we will study the asexual reproduction by the formation of zoospores, and zoospores are also known as symzoospores. Just like I think you remember what we have studied in Cara, then Idagonium, etc. about the formation of zoospores and the reproduction by zoospores. So the development of zoospores is similar to what we have studied earlier. Okay, and the zoospore, it is multi-flagellate and multi-nucleate and produced in a club-shaped sporangium. This is a sporangium, and the zoospore, it is multi-flagellate. There are numerous flagella and multi-nucleate. Usually in the case of Vaucheria, each flagella arises from the nucleus. So there are numerous nuclei in Vaucheria because of the cenocytic condition. From each nuclei, a flagella develops. So it is multi-flagellate and multi-nucleate and produced in a club-shaped sporangium. And during the development of zoosporangium, the tip portion of the side branch, this is the portion of the side branch, and this tip portion, it starts swelling. You can see a swelling here. It starts swelling and it becomes club-shaped. Now the shape is like a club shape. Then the dense cytoplasm along with large number of nuclei and chromatophores flow into the cell, followed by appearance of a septa. Normally, we have studied, when we studied the vegetative structure, that it is a septate and septa is formed at the time of reproduction. Now, we are studying asexual reproduction. So, during the formation of zoospore, the zoosporangium bulges and forms a club shape, and during that time all the nucleus and chromatophores flows into that region, and here a septa is formed separating this portion from the remaining filament, and the central vacuole reduces, and the zoosporangium, now the shape of zoosporangium turns into dark green. From yellow green the color turns into dark green. And the nuclei exchange their position from chromatophores. Now, chromatophores will be seen towards the center and nuclei towards the periphery. Nuclei, due to the formation of zoospores, nuclei towards the periphery and chromatophores towards the central portion. And the protoplasm starts contracting from the cell wall and changes into zoospores. And how zoospores are liberated? See here, the zoospores are liberated and are called symzoospores or compound zoospores. So this portion breaks and zoospores are liberated. And I have said the nuclei occupies the peripheral portion, and at the end of each nuclei, a flagella is formed. This, it becomes multinucleate, and the zoospore escapes by breaking this portion of the zoosporangium. It escapes. And now, it is known as symzoospore or the compound zoospores. And after the liberation of the zoospores, it comes to a rest for some time of period. Then it withdraws its flagella. The flagella is lost and it becomes round in shape. And after that, it secretes a cell wall around it. And now the nuclei and chromatophore exchange their position. Nuclei moves inward and chromatophores towards the peripheral portion. Now the zoospore gives out two tubular outgrowth and one branches and forms whole first, that is the rhizome, and the other grows further and forms a new thallus. Can see the germination of zoospore here. It forms a thick wall, then the portion germinating and a young filament is formed. Haptera is formed here and a young filament is formed here. The germination of zoospores and zygote formation. Then, so the first type of asexual reproduction is by the formation of zoospores. Then second one is the formation of aplanospores. Asexual reproduction, second one, the formation of aplanospores. And aplanospores, they are like zoospores. Their formation is like zoospores. But what is the difference between zoospore and aplanospore is that zoospore is multi-flagellate, but aplanospores, they lack flagella. Flagella is completely absent in aplanospores. So because of the absence of flagella, they are non-motile spores. So aplanospores, they are the non-motile spores produced under unfavorable condition, and they are produced inside aplanosporangium. This is a part of the branching filament, and this is known as aplanosporangium, like zoosporangium. Aplanosporangium, aplanospores are produced inside aplanosporangium, and all the process of formation is similar to zoosporangium, except the flagella is absent. And after the maturation, the tip of the aplanosporangium, they open and the aplanospores are released and they germinate and form new filament. Then third type of asexual reproduction is by the formation of echinets. Echinets, you remember echinets? We have studied echinets in Chlorophyceae members, and echinets, they are known as resting spores. And in this case, in Vaucheria, echinets, they are also known as cis or hypnospores. They are also known as, and the name of echinets is cis or hypnospores. And all these are resting spores, and they are produced during unfavorable condition. And on the return of favorable condition, they germinate and form a new thallus. So this is the formation of echinets is seen here. They will be having a thick wall in order to overcome the unfavorable condition. And their echinets, they are produced in dichotomous branches in rows. They are produced in dichotomous branches in rows. You can see rows here. And this stage is known as Gangrocera stage because it resembles a green algae Gangrocera. The formation of echinets in Vaucheria, that stage is known as Gangrocera stage because at this stage, the Vaucheria thallus looks like another algae, which is known as Gangrocera. So the formation of echinet stage, it is also known as Gangrocera stage. And with the return of favorable condition, echinets germinate and they form new plants. So there are three types of asexual reproduction. First one is by formation of zoospores. Second one, aplanospores. Third one, echinets. And echinets, they are also known as cis or hypnospores. Next is the process of sexual reproduction in Vaucheria. And the sexual reproduction is of oogamous type. In most of the algal forms, the type of sexual reproduction involved is oogamous type, oogamy. Oogamous or oogamy. And oogamy means there are two sex organs, male sex organ anthridium and female sex organ oogonium. And the female sex organ is larger than the male sex organ. Also, male sex organ is motile and the female sex organ is non-motile. In most of the species of Vaucheria, this homothallic, that is both the male and female sex organs are born on the same filament. but in few they are heterothallic or dioecious, that is male and female sex organs are born on separate plants. These are the stages in the development of sex organs. First we can study the development of anthridium. In the development of anthridium, initially a short lateral branch like a vegetative branch projects out, and a large number of nuclei and chromatophores accumulates towards the apical region. The apical region then bends like a horn, and a transverse septum is laid down which differentiates the apical anthridium. See here, this is a vegetative branch. It projects out. Then what happens? The nuclei and chromatophores migrate to this region. Okay, then it bends. Bends like this. And after that, numerous nuclei chromatophores flows into this region. And after that, here a septa is formed. This bends like a hook. Then what happens? The nuclei of the anthridium aggregate in the center and divides mitotically. There is a the nucleus divides mitotically, and each nucleus along with some cytoplasm metamorphoses into single spindle shaped biflagellate anthrozoid. Then it becomes a biflagellate anthrozoid. The flagella are unequal in length or dissimilar, one whiplash and other tinsel, and are laterally inserted. The anthrozoids are generally liberated through the opening developed at the apical region of the anthridium. So what happens? First of all, the vegetative branch behaves like anthridial branch. It bends. Then all the nuclei and cytoplasm migrate to this portion. Then a septa is formed. Then the mitotic division of nuclei in this region, and it develops into biflagellate anthrozoids, and the anthrozoids liberate by a slit is formed here, and through this slit anthrozoids are liberated. The formation of anthrozoids after, you can see here, after the mitotic division of the nucleus, each nucleus, numerous anthrozoids are formed here, biflagellate anthrozoids are formed here. And after that, a pore for a slit is formed, and through this anthrozoids are liberated. Now the anthridium is empty. Okay, hope you have understood. Then next is development of oogonium. Now, how oogonium is developed? Initially, a small protuberance develops at or near the base of the anthridial branch due to the accumulation of the cytoplasm. The cytoplasm in this region is colorless, which has many nuclei and without any chromatophores. And this colorless multinucleate mass of cytoplasm is known as van der plasm. Here, this is an anthridial branch. So near to that, a region of protuberance develops, and in this region, cytoplasm is colorless, but it contains numerous nuclei, but no chromatophores. And this colorless region, it is known as van der plasm. And this region develops into oogonium. Okay, then the ball of the thalli near the van der plasm bulges out and forms oogonial initial, which gradually enlarges, and consequently many chromatophores migrate into it. Gradually that region bulges out, and the many chromatophores migrate into it. With the further development, the oogonial initial become round or ovoid in shape with a beak at the apex, and gets separated from the rest of the filament by transverse septa. So after some time, all the chromatophores, nuclei, all migrates here. Then at last, a septa is formed. Okay, septa is formed here. Then nuclei, chromatophores are present. The septa is formed here. The mature oogonium contains a large nucleus at the center with many chromatophores and oil droplets dispersed throughout the cytoplasm. So the mature oogonium contains one single nucleus, large nucleus at the center, and the chromatophores and oil droplets are dispersed throughout the cytoplasm. And we know that Vaucheria is cenocytic. That means it contains numerous nuclei. And how a single nucleus formed here? All the nucleus except this central nucleus degenerates. So a single nucleus is remaining here. Understood. Then the protoplasm along with nucleus rounds off and forms a single ovum or egg. It has a hilum area towards the anterior known as receptive spore. Now all the protoplasm surrounds around this nucleus and forms a single ovum or egg. Now the oogonium contains it at center a single egg, and there is a at its tip there is a receptive spore for receiving the anthrozoids or the male gametes. And during the fertilization, what happens is that both the sex organs open almost at the same time. Now you see the position here. This is anthrozoid, anthridium, and this is oogonium. And this is the tip of anthridium, and this is the tip of oogonium. And this tip and this tip opens at the same time. The tip of the beak of oogonium gelatinizes and forms an aperture. Simultaneously, an aperture is also formed at the apex of anthridium. A small drop of colorless cytoplasm oozes out through the beak of oogonium, and several anthrozoids coming out from the anthridium get entangled in this drop. So from the oogonium, colorless cytoplasm drop is oozed out, and the anthrozoids coming from the anthridium, they get they get entangled in this drop. And several anthrozoids come, only one healthy anthrozoid enter into this oogonium and fuses with egg nucleus, and they form a diploid zygote. You can see here from this spore a cytoplasm, a drop, a fluid comes out, and this anthrozoid get entangled in that fluid, and through this pore one healthy anthrozoid enter and fuses with this egg. The fusing of male and female nuclei, and a zygote, a diploid zygote is formed. This is a formation of diploid zygote. The zygote secretes 3 to 7 layered wall around it. Then the protoplast accumulates oil droplets. Initially, the zygote remains green, but later it becomes red due to the breakdown of chlorophyll. It remains within the oogonium and later comes out by decay of the oogonial wall. Later, during its maturation, the oogonial wall decays and the zygote comes out. And it remains dormant for a long time until favorable condition comes. And during the favorable condition, the zygote germinates and forms a new thallus. It undergoes first two meiotic division, followed by several mitotic division. It forms a new thallus. First of all, that rhizoidal portion or the haptor is formed, and then the upward portion, filament portion, is also formed. This is the picture showing the germinating zygote. Okay, this is the haptera portion. This is the young filament portion. This is stages in the germination of zygote and formation of new Vaucheria plant body. So this is the schematic diagram showing the life cycle of Vaucheria. So Vaucheria belongs to the class Anthophyceae, and mostly the questions will ask about the sexual reproduction.